I want to take you live to Iraq. A quick update on our top story. Donald Trump says Iran appears to be standing down after firing missiles at those bases housing American troops in Iraq. And Iraq is the proxy battlefield. It was, at least in this case, the site of both the U.S. strike that killed Qassem Soleimani and also the site of Iran's retaliatory missile attack. And we're getting new images from that country tonight. Take a look at these satellite images of the damage at al-Asad Air Base. Sam Kiley is in Baghdad. What are we learning from these new, this new satellite imagery, Sam?
Well, I think two things, Hala, both the power and the accuracy of these what would appear to be highly capable Iranian missiles fired over considerable range with considerable accuracy, if we accept, and it broadly is now accepted, that they were deliberately targeted so as to avoid any casualties and they were fired following tip-offs to the Iraqi government here in Baghdad that were passed on to the United States so that service personnel could get into hardcover and avoid being hit by these missiles. 17 fired into the al-Assad base, 15 detonated, no casualties, and 5 into US coalition targets in the northern Kurdish areas of Iraq, Hala. So what this does signal, though, from the Iranian perspective, is capability. Now, the reaction here in Baghdad has been one of official outrage from the president and the speaker in the parliament here, rejection, in his words, from the prime minister. But more importantly, I think in many ways, Hala, the Iranian-backed Shia militias here, notably Kataib Hezbollah, have said that this is the first salvo in what they say is revenge for the killing of the leader of Kataib Hezbollah, who died alongside Qassem Soleimani in that US airstrike last Friday. They have vowed to fight on in order to force the United States to withdraw from Iraq. I think from the American and Iraqi perspective, that is going to remain a very thorny issue in the coming days and weeks, Hala.
Thank you, Sam Kiley in Baghdad. Well, senior Trump administration officials are briefing Senate lawmakers about Iran right now, all about the intelligence that was used to justify the strike against Qassem Soleimani. A short time ago, the entire House of Representatives was briefed on the situation. Democrats in the House are also seeking to restrain the president's military actions with a vote on war powers. Phil Mattingly is in Washington on Capitol Hill. I spoke to one congressperson who told me earlier in the hour he didn't hear anything that made him change his mind, a Democrat from New Jersey, saying we didn't really hear anything convincing that we felt justified this strike, that they thought the president was reckless. But the senators will be briefed behind closed doors, correct?
That's exactly right. It will essentially be the same briefing by the same administration officials. And a lot of the people you saw standing behind the president during his Iran remarks earlier at the White House will also be now briefing senators. And this is something that both Democrats and Republicans have been calling for in the wake of the strike that targeted and killed Qassem Soleimani. And I think the big question, and you kind of hit on this with what you were talking about with the Democrat you spoke to earlier, is the idea of how imminent it was, right? It is the thing that nobody can really grasp yet to this point. And this includes House lawmakers, as you spoke to, who had the briefing already, is what is the evidence based on the intelligence, particularly intelligence from the CIA director, Gina Haspel, who is briefed the House, will brief the Senate, that made clear that this was something that had to happen now. When you put it all in context, based on the Bush administration and the Obama administration deciding to pass on the opportunity to strike Qassem Soleimani, what was different at this point in time? And you talk to Democrats who had the briefing in the House, they said they hadn't seen anything that made them believe that this was something that had to happen now. Now, you talk to Republicans who were in the House briefing, and they say the exact opposite. They say it was laid out in detail, a series of potential plans, potential attacks, all lining up with what has occurred over the course of the past couple of months that brought the Trump administration to this point. Look, I think the bottom line here, particularly given what we've seen in the wake of the Soleimani strike, is kind of where things go from here. I think the briefings right now are supposed to be about the strike, are supposed to be about the intelligence that led to that strike, but there are also significant questions, particularly from Democrats, about about what is the next step from the administration. Obviously, Democrats were happy with the president's remarks to the extent this morning they didn't show any sign of new escalation. But what is the broader plan? What are the broader proposals? And frankly, how prepared is the United States for anything that may come next? Those are questions that lawmakers have. They don't necessarily know that they'll be answered during the Senate briefing that's going on as we speak. But that's why you see the administration officials up here, and that's why you see Democrats still very wary about why this took place, when this took place, and kind of what the rationale is going forward for the U.S.-Iran strategy.
All right, Phil Mattingly, thanks very much. Well, as far as world leaders are concerned, they are calling and have been calling for restraint and de-escalation between the U.S. and Iran. The Russian President Vladimir Putin and the Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdogan issued a joint statement saying their countries are deeply concerned. Mr. Erdogan said that Turkey will not allow the region, quote, to be drowned in blood and tears. The British Prime Minister went before Parliament today and condemned the Iranian attack on U.S. military bases in Iraq. Boris Johnson defended, though, the U.S. strike that killed Qassem Soleimani, saying Soleimani had the blood of British troops on his hands. William Patey joins me now. He's a former British ambassador to Iraq, Afghanistan, and Saudi Arabia. Sir William, thanks for being with us. First of all, your reaction to what Donald Trump said, the world was on tenterhooks waiting to see if he would announce a further escalation or if he would dial it back. He chose to dial it back.
Yes, I think the Iranians were very careful in their attack. It was measured, it was forewarned. And I think Trump very quickly set the tone in his tweet that all is well. So mm-hmm. I think both sides have been looked at the abyss and have drawn back from it. But the underlying problems remain. Of course, yeah. the strategic position has not changed. Indeed, it's moved in Iran's favour, I think.
Mm-hmm. Could this set the stage for some sort of negotiation?
Well, I don't think negotiation right away. I think there should be talks, because the only alternative to this is war.
Sure.
So there should be talks. I think before this, I was at a conference in the Middle East and some Iranians suggested there might be a scope for reopening the nuclear deal and talking about Iranian role in Lebanon and Syria and Yemen. If that was on the table, you would have the basis for talks, but I don't think they represented the hardliners in Iran, and I think they're calling the shots now.
But so what will it take to break this impasse?
I don't know in the end. I mean, Iran certainly doesn't want to just sit there and wait for maximum pressure to play out. The American strategy is to create maximum pressure on the Iranians to come back to the negotiating table. Yeah. So that is their aim, to get them back to the negotiating table. The Iranians do not want to come to the negotiating table under pressure, and they may well, through their proxies, and they've got, you know, Hezbollah in Lebanon and Syria and elsewhere, they've played a very destructive role in other parts of the Middle East, through their proxies may set to raise the temperature once again without invoking a more substantial U.S. strike.
Right. Qassem Soleimani, his death, does it change anything operationally, do you think?
I don't think so. I think the IRGC still had its network throughout the Middle East, particularly in Lebanon through Hezbollah. They have a very strong network in Syria where they've wreaked havoc. They still have all those contacts. Soleimani himself was quite a master tactician and was personally responsible for quite a lot of the mayhem in the Middle East.
I mean, he was in fact a battlefield commander inside of Syria. I mean, this is someone who really took charge.
Yes, and he not only was a battlefield commander, he was also a strategist and a politician. Yeah. So he had good contacts with Assad. He was propping up the Assad regime. He has contacts with Hezbollah. So his loss will be a temporary setback, but the IRGC has tentacles everywhere and will replace him. Well, they've already placed him with his deputy, Ismail Qani. So he may not have his skill and charisma to begin with, but that can be, Qassem Soleimani developed that over time.
But the tragedy here is that all of this is once again destroying the lives of civilians. In this case, in Iraq, for instance, you have, of course, the disaster that is Syria. And all these people in that part of the world, do they have anything to be hopeful about?
No, the real victims are the Arab the Arab peoples of Syria and Lebanon and Iraq, and indeed the Iranians themselves who are suffering from sanctions. So the real victims are the ordinary people of the Middle East. And what needs to happen is some, I think, ultimately some form of regional security arrangement where Iran accepts that it can't be interfering in Arab countries, that it has a legitimate right to security, but it mustn't secure that security by basically ruining Lebanon, Syria, and Iraq.
Right, and using so much of that territory for its own proxy battles and proxy militant groups like Hezbollah in Iran. And we did hear from Hassan Nasrallah, who basically is threatening retaliation.
Yes, and,
as well.
And who would that be against? That would be against Israel.
Sure.
And we know what happens when Hezbollah clash with Israel. The people who suffer are the Lebanese.